Vi kridhinta dhindinta. Kridhinta dhindinta. Kridhinta dhindinta. Takinata dhinta dhinta dhinta.
Good evening and a very warm welcome to everybody present here. My pranam to the elders, love and regards to all my friends, peers and colleagues present here today. Some of you may know me, probably very few know me here, but as a wishful musician and tabla player, but even fewer may be aware that I also have an interest in academics, theatre, fashion and especially cinema. Though undeniably, music is for the most part the language that speaks most to me. When I was approached by Indranidhi at the IIC, I was half expecting being invited to perform the tabla at one of the regular programs organized by the center across the calendar year, but little to my knowledge did I know that there was something more sinister brewing. But humor apart, I was quite befuddled on learning that I was actually being asked to present a talk at the center, and that too on a personality of the stature of Ustad Alla Rakha. So even as I stand before you today, I'm still not convinced really if it was the best decision on the part of IIC to invite me. But because considering my age and whatever little experience that I have, but for my part I am really, really honored to have been given this opportunity to speak even a little about only some of the things that endeared me to this legendary Ustad, one who continues till this day to inspire us in thinking beyond what we have been taught and to propagate the cause of Indian music across the world. Now, before beginning my talk in front of such an elite and knowledgeable audience, I'd like to acknowledge the support of a few people who have encouraged me to prepare this discussion in the way that it has finally turned out. I would firstly thank Mr. Patu Dotto, who has been a guide through academics, and also for this reference particularly, Ms. Indrani Majumdar, for giving me such a great opportunity, Mr. Pramontho Mohan Tagore, for helping me figure out the process, Mr. Omid Chatterjee, the nephew of Pandit Shankho Chattopadhyay, Nasreen Munni Kabir's book on Ustad Zakir Hussain, Pandit Yogesh Samsiji, and the age-old association that my family has with the Qureshis. After a good deal of consideration, I thought about changing the name of the talk that I'm going to present today. The poster has a different name, but I've changed it to Beyond the Syllable, 100 Years of Ustad Alla Rakha, to partly uncover the life of the maestro outside the tabla, but also bring to the forefront elements of his musical life that have hitherto have been lacking from common knowledge. But to start, we will start with a clip of Ustad Alla Rakha, which to me is a very traditional tabla solo and very old one. I found this in a NFDC documentary. I guess you'll know it.
मेरा पंजाब घराना है और वो पखावज घराना है, पखावजी घराना है, मेरे उस्ताद के 1.25 लाख शागिर्द हैं, उनमें से मैं भी एक हूं।
He was born in the year 1919 on 29th April in Pagwal, a small village at the border of Jammu and Punjab. The young Alla Rakha was brought up in a very humble household. Growing up on a farm, he was always in awe of music and was enamored by traveling musicians who happened to pass through his village from time to time. His father, Hashim Ali Qureshi, soon shifted to Ramri by the river Ravi in Shakargarh and settled there. For those of you who might be wondering, Ramri is in present-day Pakistan. And I have read in certain sources that Hashim Ali Qureshi was also involved in theatre, and particularly in theatre music. Possibly one of the most significant events that shaped his early life was when, as a young boy of 11, Alla Rakha ran away from his family to Lahore to stay with his uncle. I haven't found the name of the uncle because he has always referred to him as Chacha Ji. Deeply interested in music, this was a wise choice, as Lahore was, at the point at least, an extremely important cultural center in northwestern India. Eventually, acquiring a menial job in a shop, Alla Rakha had still not come across his main problem, the search for a suitable guru. Some biographers suggest that the idea of a traveling musician haunted Alla Rakha so much so that wanting to live a life of musical travel was nothing short of an overpowering desire. In Lahore, he came across several musical genres and live events and became overtly engrossed in the rhythmic applications used in those genres. Being a center for artistic excellence, baithaks and mehfils were regular events hosted in several aristocratic and middle class households in Lahore. Afternoon music gatherings were common, and in fact it was being present in one such baithak that changed the life of young Alla Rakha completely. Khan Sahab's uncle was aware of his young nephew's musical inclination and made it a point to take him to these baithaks. Around 1932, when he was around 12 or 13 years of age, in one such baithak, a Dhrupadiya was singing all day and the tabla player was struggling to decipher the composition. All in vain, the Dhrupadiya stopped and asked the audience as to whether anybody could accompany him in the place of the tabla player on stage. To everyone's surprise, a young boy stood up and asked for permission to accompany the pandit. The boy sat, took up his instrument and played aptly with the Dhrupadiya. and the performance, which was prematurely halted, was a complete success. Post-concert, several senior connoisseurs came up to Alla Rakha's uncle to ask from whom he learns. His uncle, bewildered at the questions, but not hesitant enough, indicated that the young boy did not learn officially from anyone, but owing to his passion and love for music, he could play so fluently with whatever maturity and grace. The connoisseurs suggested that evening that Alla Rakha should definitely be taken to a good guru because of his musical gift, one that should always be nurtured. This incident made his uncle understand the degree of the young boy's merit. He took Alla Rakha to one of the most well-known masters of tabla in the neighborhood, representing the Punjab gharana, Ustad Mia Kadir Baksh. This is a photo of Ustad Mia Kadir Baksh. In later years, Khan Sahab often confessed that he already knew and he had already seen his guru in his dreams, and so realized that this was perfectly in tandem with his destiny. In an article, I read that when Kadir Baksh Khan Sahab asked him that, when he first went there, he heard his tabla and asked him, "From whom do you learn?" And he instantly said, "From you." And Khan Sahab actually accepted him. In later years, the initial training period spanned over 6 years, following which Kadir Baksh ji sent him to Ustad Ashik Ali Khan Sahab to study vocal music. Once again, for those in the audience who might not know, Ashik Ali Khan Sahab from Patiala was a renowned vocalist and also a guru to Ustad Bade Ghulam Ali Khan Sahab. This was a major advantage for Abbaji in his career. Abbaji, still a young man of 17, joined the Lahore station of the All India Radio in the year 1936. 2 years later, in 1938, he was promoted to the position of a permanent staff member specializing in vocal music, performing the tabla, and remarkably as a composer. For his good work, in 1940, he was transferred to Mumbai, where the next stage of his career officially began. Arriving in Mumbai was possibly one of the most exhilarating experience for Ustad Alla Rakha. He was immediately exposed to Indian film music and the larger world of Indian cinema. Subsequently, he began composing for films directly under the name of A.R. Qureshi, and fascinatingly is known to have worked on around 35 to 36 films, out of which at least 10 were blockbusters such as Madari, Bewafa, Sabak, Maa Baap, and many more. Unlike other musicians who might have been drawn to the glamour of the film industry, Alla Rakha Khan Sahab was nevertheless interested in developments occurring in the classical music world. Bombay at the time, like Lahore, also had an active Hindustani music culture, which dominated the public sphere. Having opportunity to frequently perform in the city was both an accomplishment and for many a way of life. It was in Bombay that he made acquaintance with Pandit Ravi Shankar, and even though it was still early days, Khan Sahab started touring with the maestro, which began a new era in the history of Indian music in India and in the West, one that has been enormously documented to the extent that it makes little sense to recount it here. To briefly recount, he married Bawi Begum, who hailed from a village in the same province where he came from and had 7 children with her. The first 3 were daughters, Bilkis, Khurshid and Razia, and the final were 4 sons, Zakir, Munawar, Fazal and Tawfiq. Now I deeply apologize for referring to such prominent personalities this way, but considering the life Khansab led in today's time, it seems like fiction. All his sons, even if I discount the Ustad Zakir Hussain, all of them are extremely gifted and have made significant contributions to the world of music. I have chosen to divide today's talk into 3 different, not much talked about aspects of Khansab's life. This is the reason why I named it differently. The 3 things are his work as a music director, B, his association with Kolkata, and 3, his love and passion for tals with unusual rhythmic cycles. As you can see, the first solo that he was playing was in 11 beats, Char Taal Ki Sawari. Char Taal Ki Sawari, the video is from end of 1950s. It's quite a rare thing in 1950s to play Char Taal Ki Sawari. So anyway, I would start with the first segment. This is a family photo of Ustad Alla Rakha. This was just when he shifted to Bombay.
What year is this?
1940.
None
of them played, but
other instruments?
No, but Razia, the girl Razia Apa, who was the youngest daughter, was very deeply involved in the industry because she was a manager to Zakir ji for a real long time.
When was Zakir born?
I would say 51. 51, is it? Yeah, no, I guess he is 2 years elder to my uncle. So if my uncle is 1952, he would be 1950 or something like that. We would start with the first topic, but would watch a beautiful piece of performance of Khansab and his son Zakir ji, which would let us an insight to the relationship they shared. And noticeably, Fazal ji and Tawfiq ji is sitting behind him in this video. I guess it's somewhere abroad.
Thank you.
This was Rupak. This was Rupak. It's a 7-beat cycle. So again, he had this fascination to play all the tals except teen tal. I wouldn't put it that way, that he didn't like teen tal or something like that. But he has a fascination for other tals as well, which was quite great for the fraternity and the students, because we have maestros and a big history of maestros who have composed for teen tal. But the culture of playing and composing in Rupak, in Char Tal Ki Sawari, in Jhap Tal, was not really there for the most part of the history of tabla. But Abbaji's compositions take a very important place in this history, because he had composed elaborately in Rupak, Char Tal Ki Sawari, and all of those tals that he performed. I would come to that when I'm speaking about that in the third segment. So the first segment is about him as a music composer when he was in Bombay. Now this is the favorite part of this thing that I'm doing, because there is no documentation of him as a composer. There's a very little, one or two videos. Otherwise, I had a hard time to find even the songs that he composed, but they are so beautiful. So Khan Sahab was an employee of Mohan Studios since 1943, located slightly in the interior part of Andheri, Mumbai, which was quite far from his home in Mahim. They used to live in Mahim in Bombay, apparently. The Simla house flat that they have now was much later bought. He got the opportunity to work at the studio from AIR while working there as a composer, which he joined in the year 1940. For example, to think of his genius as a composer, I would tell you to listen to this song. But before that, this is the present picture of Mohan Studios. It's no more a studio, it's more of office, but it's still there, the space is there. Very interestingly, Mughal-e-Azam was shot in one of the floors of Mohan Studio. And I know this from a story, because Zakir Ji auditioned for Mughal-e-Azam. So he has referred to that. This is a song from the film Vamik Azra of 1946. We can hear Abbaji's voice in this song. Apparently he starts singing. It's a duet song with Nasreen Akhtar. But the first verse is...
I'm
I wouldn't say that this is exactly in Chandrakosh, but not totally, actually. Not totally, yeah. So, like, it's Mishra Chandrakosh, I guess, yeah. But interestingly, this is composed in the old ghazal style where you have the antara in ad lib. Throughout his career as a music composer, he not only worked for Mohan Studios, but freelanced for other studios and production houses as well. Among the blockbusters were Bewafa, Maa Baap, Sabak, Madari, Khandan, and many more. A fascinating aspect of his compositions was the amalgamation of the Western musical idioms with Indian classical formats. Listen to this song from the film Maa Baap. Please pay attention to the music arrangement. The song is set in an Indian arrangement, whereas all the interlude music has a distinctive Western approach.
जिस दिन इस दुनिया से नफरत और खुदगर्ज़ी मिट जाएगी, जिस दिन इस दुनिया से नफरत और खुदगर्ज़ी मिट जाएगी, उस रोज ये इंसान नाचेगा, उस रोज ये धरती गाएगी, उस रोज ये धरती गाएगी। इस टुकड़े पर हक मेरा है, उस चप्पे पर हक तेरा है, इस टुकड़े पर हक मेरा है, उस चप्पे पर हक तेरा है, इस वहम में जब तक है दुनिया, समझो के दूर सवेरा है, जब दुख सुख सब मिल बांटेंगे और उल्फत साज बजाएगी, उस रोज ये इंसान आएगा, उस रोज ये धरती गाएगी, उस रोज ये धरती गाएगी। इंसान के दिल में जब तक भी ताकत का नशा और लालच है, इंसान के दिल में जब तक भी ताकत का नशा और लालच है, ये दुनिया जहन्नुम ही होगी, ये आज भी सच कल भी सच है, जब अपनी अपनी मेहनत ही सबकी दौलत कहलाएगी, उस रोज ये इंसान आएगा, उस रोज ये धरती जाएगी, उस रोज ये धरती जाएगी।
No, no. This is Mohammed Rafi. Yeah. Who? I don't know. I know it's beautiful, no? Yeah. I know. I know it's beautiful. Actually, Rajendra. Oh, it's written. Rajendra Kumar is playing a. No. The actor Rajendra Kumar is actually playing a poet in the film. So therefore. There is such great lyrics in it, yeah. Anyway, coming back to the song, you have noticed that all the interludes have a Western arrangement. The rhythms are in double bass, there are violin groups playing, and as it comes back to the song, there are Indian rhythms. Achha, this song particularly I was engrossed in because let's listen to this and then I'll talk about this. I only found this is.
हमारे साथ मोटर में चलो.
If you notice, this song is in a Bhopali or Shudh Kalyan area. Now the reason this song I'm particularly playing is the song is in Bhopali Shudh Kalyan area, not exactly Shudh Kalyan, but no way, if you see the movie or listen to the song, it doesn't make you feel as Shudh Kalyan. It's not that. There's a Madhyam. And even that, like the Mukhra has that thing. So my point is, it takes a lot of knowledge and command over a certain raga or something like that, or particularly the music, to actually compose a song in a particular raga and maintain that grammar and syntax, but also not make the person who's listening to it feel the heaviness of that raga. It's just a movie song, a peppy number. The heroine is driving with her friends and it's fantastic. The person who knows Shudh Kalyan will realize that this is Shudh Kalyan. Otherwise, it's fun. So this is something, I wouldn't say Abbaji is the only one to have that, but that generation of composers mostly had that. So this is interesting. This excerpt is, not excerpt, a video is of Abbaji of another documentary where he's speaking about composition. This is much later in his life. Sorry.
मुझे दौर का कुछ पता नहीं, मुझे अपने आप का पता है। जो मेरा म्यूजिक है वो अपनी जगह स्टिल है और हम उसको ही मानते हैं। और कहो कि फिल्मों में ऐसा हुआ, ये ऐसा हुआ, आई डोंट लाइक दैट। अभी कंपोजिशन भी जो है, पहले पता लग जाता था कि फलाना का है, भाई ये फलाने का है, ये नौशाद का है या शंकर जाकिशन का या किसी का भी पता, गुलाम हैदर का मालूम हो जाता था कि हाँ भाई उनका है, पता नहीं लगता किसी का कि किसका है किसका नहीं है, कंपोज किसका है, कंपोजिशन किसने की है, मालूम नहीं पड़ता है। वो सब एक ही जैसा है। तो हमारे जमाने में जो हमारा जो कंपोजिशन था वो सब राग को बेस करता था, किसी राग को भी ले लिया, या चंद्रकांत को ले लिया, दुर्गा को ले लिया, भैरवी को ले लिया, ऐसे रागों को बेस करके तो ट्यून कंपोज करते थे। तो ये मैसेज जैसी है, ये स्थान है, तो इसी राग को किसी कंपोज को करना, ट्यून को करना तो इसमें करना है, और किसी को मिला के करेंगे तो कुछ अजीब सा लगता।
नाउ द लास्ट सॉन्ग दैट आई कुड गेट होल्ड ऑफ, दिस इज माय फेवरेट सॉन्ग ऑफ व्हाटएवर आई फाउंड, एंड दिस इज इन मिश्र जिंजोटी। This is sung by Talat Mahmood. Please do not miss the super charming Raj Kapoor in it. And Nargis, of course. My God.
Dil mat wala naak sambhala, दिल मत वाला नाक संभाला, फिर भी किसी पर आ ही गया, शोक नजर से देखने वाला, शोक नजर से देखने वाला, प्यार का रोग लगा ही गया, दिल मत वाला नाक संभाला। नया जमाना, नई तरंगे, नया तराना, नई उमंगे, नया जमाना, नई तरंगे, नया तराना, मस्त नजर से तीर चला के, मस्त नजर से तीर चला के, कोई हमें तड़पा ही गया, दिल मत वाला नाक संभाला। ओ मदहोश निगाहों वाले, तेरी कसम दिल तेरे हवाले, ओ मदहोश निगाहों वाले, तेरी कसम दिल तेरे हवाले, देखा इस अंदाज से तुमने, देखा इस अंदाज से तुमने, प्यार किसी को आ ही गया, दिल मत वाला नाक संभाला। कर गए बातें दो मत वाले, देखते रह गए देखने वाले, कर गए बातें दो मत वाले, देखते रह गए देखने वाले, कोई किसी को राजे मोहब्बत, कोई किसी को राजे मोहब्बत, आँखों में समझा ही गया, दिल मत वाला नाक संभाला, फिर भी किसी पर आ ही गया, दिल मत वाला ला संभाला।
Such a lovely song. Now Calcutta. Ustad Alla Rakha started traveling to Calcutta for various music related activities towards the end of the 1940s when he was still young and very much in his prime. As he recognized as a recognized film composer at that point of time, his career as a musician, as a performing musician, had just started. And as he began making a name for himself in a wider urban music circles in the country, though he did accompany several prominent musicians specializing in vocal and instrumental music, where he made his name at that point in time, was though his unparalleled skill in performing tabla solos were mostly famous. He had a tabla solo in all the conferences, irrespective of whatever the item he's playing. Among his close friends and members of the music circle he was involved in, one can easily name a few people who, through their own repertoire, talent and influence, had taken the industry by storm. Sharafat Hussain Khan Saab, Nisar Hussain Khan Saab, Karamatullah Khan Saab, and many more. These were people residing in Calcutta at that point of time. Though many artists from all over India used to go to Calcutta and reside there from November to January or February, because that was quite a center. So they used to base themselves in Calcutta and then travel. And hotel was not that popular. They had disciples, they had patrons. At their residence, they used to stay. They were not like really interested in staying in hotel, because they used to stay there, play their concerts, and have baithaks every evening in that house. So that was the major interesting part for them. His association also extended to more renowned and senior performers such as Ustad Bade Ghulam Ali Khan Saab and Ustad Salamat Ali Khan Saab. Ustad Alla Rakha was also a regular in this locality called Tala Pada in North Calcutta, which had as its residence as some of the great and most influential Bengali musicians of that time. Hirendra Kumar Ganguly, Shyam Ganguly, Natu Babu, who is Krishna Kumar Ganguly, and even my grandfather, Pandit Shankar Ghosh, my grandfather Acharya Bishwanath Bose, to just name a few. It so happens that Bagh Bazar, which is a locality in North Calcutta, was very closer to this place, where another legend lived named Pandit Onatnath Bose. These are some of the pictures that I got, but I didn't get hold of pictures of that time.
Hmm? That's
Bhimsen. Yeah, that's Bhimsen. I think this photo of Pandit. Yeah, I think this photo of Pandit Bhimsen Joshi is in Pune. A friend of mine in Pune sent me this.
Is that your
grandfather? Mm-hmm. No, my grandfather, like. There isn't lots of pictures of 1940s, that period, you know. People didn't have that much of photo cameras or something like that. Which one? The
Chopin.
Yeah, that's Pandit Chopin Choudhury. Chitresh Das. Yeah, yeah. This is of America. This picture is from America. Yeah. Possibly, I don't know the incident, but this picture is from America. Maybe they were traveling and Khan Saab went to listen to their concert, but Chitresh Das was there in America. He shifted to America at that point of time. Achha, coming back to Bagh Bazar. Oh, this is also a good picture. Yeah. This is from Bombay, Sitara Devi's. from ye oh great thank you this is zakir ji then it's fazal ji then khan sahab then sultan khan sahab and then sitara devi ji no sultan khan sahab is the great sarangi maestro yeah ustad sultan khan sahab yeah and this is I suppose the person I got from he said this is ustad bismillah khan sahab I don't know but I don't think so oh okay and this is ustad amjad ali khan sahab in between Yeah. Who is the one?
Who knows?
Which one?
On the right of Amjad.
It's Khan Sahab. Alla Rakha Khan Sahab. Yeah. It's very old, I think. Because Amjad Ali Khan Sahab looks really young. Ah, this is Bagh Bazar. So coming back to Bagh Bazar. Now I've... Yeah. This is now. Yeah, if you go there, you would feel that you're 100 years back. Now, I find myself fortunate enough, in fact, because to live in the same house that Anantnath Bose used to live in. Yeah, I live in the same house. Anant Babu, now speaking about Anant Babu, I'll tell you. Anant Babu, as some of you may know, was the only Bengali maestro to get patronized by the king of Raigarh. And so had accumulated a lot of wealth at that point of time. He was an extremely knowledgeable vocalist and could sing in both male and female voices. He would sing the khayal in a rigorous male voice and then a thumri in a sweet female voice. Later, he became quite an authority of the musical scene in Calcutta. He used to invite ustads and pandits from the other provinces in India to come and perform in Calcutta, and so his house always had an atmosphere of musical discussion, conversation, and cultural exchanges. Now, I know those houses. They are rebuilt now, so there's no point taking pictures. But those were the houses which belonged to Pandit Anantnath Bose. He used to bring artists from all provinces and keep them there. And the same way, every evening they used to have baithaks. And many people from Calcutta used to actually go there to learn. That was quite an exposure.
So you live in the same house?
Yeah.
But has it been rebuilt?
My house is not rebuilt. It is just the house next to this one. I just got the picture of the crossing of the Pada.
Houses inside.
Yeah, houses inside. So, but the Pada doesn't look exactly how it used to look. Because, yeah, I have done it, I have like created the black and white because otherwise it doesn't seem like that. It has got some yellow buildings and it looks very odd. Yeah. No, I've just turned it to black and white. Now, it might be difficult to grasp the reason for why a locality where a musician resides in might be important towards his or her musical development. You see, Calcutta and particularly North Calcutta has a unique community spirit where people of all walks of life are seen to talk to each other, engage in conversations, partake in discussions over evening tea, and have the occasional pararadda and so on. These discourses, non-professional discussions and conversations not only limited to music goes a long way in shaping one's outlook towards life. And so having Ustad Alla Rakha amidst this company was sure to have uplifted the mood of interaction but also added a wholesomeness to the kind of discussion that used to take place in times of old. Moreover, discussion included a far variety of social, political, and cultural contexts. one might not be too surprised to find even the occasional pre-independent radical nationalist conversation happening in the most common households. And so these are only some things that shape our popular imagination over time. Firoz Khan Saab, who really spent a lot of time, Pandit Shankar Ghosh learned from Firoz Khan Saab and a lot of Punjab because he used to stay in Anand Babu's place. Firoz Khan Saab, Abid Hussain Khan Saab, who was probably one of the first people who brought Lucknow Baj to Calcutta. It was because of him. Though he used to stay in Hirendra Kumar Ganguly's house, Hiru Babu's house, because Hiru Babu's father was quite influential and they were not professional musicians. They were lawyers. So they could afford. Hafiz Ali Khan Saab, the father of Ustad Amjad Ali Khan Saab, and many other artists would come and live at Bagh Bazar, making the locality a treasure trove of knowledge, almost like a mini cultural center. Artists traveling to and through Calcutta would surely make it a point to visit Bagh Bazar at some point of time. I must mention here, if you do not know already, that the LP of Aina Balam, this one, this LP of Aina Balam by the Ustad Bade Ghulam Ali Khan Saab actually involves the accompaniment of Ustad Alla Rakha Khan Saab and was recorded in HMB Calcutta. 1962 it was released, it was probably recorded in 1961. A couple of days ago, I had a delightful conversation with my very dear brother Amit Chatterjee, who happens to be the nephew of Pandit Shankar Chattopadhyay, who is a senior disciple of Alla Rakha Khan Saab. He informed me that Khan Saab often chose to stay in his friend's house in Dover Lane, which is in South Kolkata. The friend in this context was P.L. Das or Pannalal Das, who is also a founder member of Doverland Music Conference, who owned a jewelry shop and was a great lover of his art. Omidda and his uncle worked closely with Khan Saab around 1961. That's the time when Pandit Shankar Chattopadhyay got his Ganda Bandhan. He says, Omidda says, as in, I was very young at that point of time, but never saw Khan Saab without his instrument. He was always playing or composing stuff and was, for the better part of my memory, seated in front of the instrument at all times. Omidda also mentions that Khan Saab did not stay for long periods in Calcutta. Even though he frequently visited the city, he used to regret the fact that he wanted to but couldn't stay in the city for too long due to his film music commitments in Bombay, and so had to travel back. Omidda also recollects that Khan Saab loved to sing. In quotes, every alternate day he would take out the harmonium and start singing Punjabi folk songs. However, those songs are rarely heard today and might in reality, if no one has recorded them yet, be lost. Khan Saab also used to talk about his childhood while singing those songs. Coming to the third part, Abbaji on odd tals. Let's listen to this audio. This is Chaar Taal Ki Sawari. Beats. No, Abbaji is probably one of the earliest exponents who freed tabla solo performance from the teen tal. He has numerous live and studio renditions of tabla solos in Jhaptal, Rupak. Jhaptal is 10 beats, Rupak is 7 beats, Sur Phak Tal, which is another 10 beat thing, tal, Matta Tal, 9 beats, Jay Tal, 13 beats, Char Tal Ki Sawari, which is 11 beats, and so on. We don't have too many archival recordings, at least they are not easily accessible, but no, I have a doubt about this, but people say that this passion of his, of playing different tals, came from his association with Ravi Shankarji. But I don't know, I don't think so, because there are certain incidents, certain stories of his compositions and his thought about compositions, which is before his association with Ravi Shankarji. So I'd like to narrate some of the compositions, but I'll tell you this story of a composition which I heard from Yogesh ji. Yogesh ji said he was a kid when he heard this composition. He was actually not even taught. He was just told ki dekho aisa hai, aisa composition maza aayega isko. So the composition was of 60 units. A chakradhar of 60 units, 60 matras. And as it's of 60 matras, it can be played in three different tals. One in jhaptal, which is 10 beats. So 10 beats in six jhaptals, this would come. Pancham Sawari, which is 15 matras. So four times Pancham Sawari would come. And even in Dhrutektal is 12. So in five circles of Dhrutektal, this would come. Now, this is a very modern thought to have in 1950s and end of 1950s and 1960s, because people were not usually playing such things. Later, we have examples of such things in Western music, jazz and hard metal rock. They play compositions fit in four cycles of different meters, like one cycle is of 12, second cycle is of 13, and again it comes back to 7, and then again 14, like that. But this, all of this happened in 90s. So this was quite surprising to me. Khan Saab's compositions always had an intricate break in it, interesting break in it, and not in a very predictable space. So if Teen Tal goes, Teen Tal is a 16 beat cycle and it has divisions of 4 fours are the divisions of 16. Khan Saab's composition would have a break in 3.5, which would be objectifying the 3.5 space of Teen Tal. Like, this is one of my favorite, which I don't generally play because it's not something that I should be playing at such an initial stage, but it's one of my favorite and I learned it from Yogesh ji. Ghenna dati dagi na dagati na ghenna ghenna dati dagi na dagati na kina kenna dati taki na dagati na ghenna ghenna dati dagi na dagati na kina ghenna. So the second ghenna comes just before the second division. So da din din na din din na na din din na trika din din na ghenna dati dagi na dagati na ghenna ghenna dati dagi na dagati na kina kenna aji dagi na dagati na ghenna ghenna dati dagi na dagati na kina ghenna aji dagi na dagati na ghenna ghenna dati dagi na dagati na kenna dati dagi na dagati na ghenna ghenna dati dagi na dagati na kina ghenna. And the bistars also goes that way. Where ghenna dati dagi na dagati na ghenna dati dagi na dagati na ghenna aji dagi na dagati na dagati na ghenna ghenna dati dagi na dagati na kina kenna aji dagi na dagati na kenna aji dagi na dagati na kenna dati dagi na dagati na ghenna ghenna dati dagi na dagati na kina ghenna. Secondly, he had compositions which had the same structure, and if you just minus or add a particular syllable, it can be played in several tals. like dhatrika dhatete ghatrika dhatete dhati gena dhati dagati na kina tatrika tatete katrika tatete dhati gena dhati dagati na kina. This is a composition in teen tal. So dhatrika dhatete ghatrika dhatete dhati gena dhati gena dhati dagati na kina tatrika tatete katrika tatete dhati gena dhati dagati na kina. Just put out one dhati gena from the composition and it fits well in rupak. Put out all the dhati genas, it fits in Jhaptal. So these set of compositions is a great great contribution to the people who are teaching tabla in India, because anyway Hindustani music tal cycle is very difficult to understand and decipher. When we have such compositions, it's easy to make somebody understand the division and make them play that tal easily. This I think is a great contribution of his, and he has several of them. Even this is what I'm talking of kaidas. He also has tukras, chakradas with the same structure. You put out one thing and it can be played in any other tal. This is a composition. The third thing is what Punjab is also about. Punjab is a lot of drama. It has a lot of drama and a lot of energy in its compositions. Which also I suppose Punjab itself has in it a lot of energy, a lot of enthusiasm. This particular tukra is a Nohari tukra. Tehai is a particular piece of composition where a particular phrase is played three times. So this is the Tehai. If we play it nine times, it becomes a Nohari Tehai, and if it's put in a Tukra, which is a certain type of composition, it becomes a Nohari Tukra. So this is
the same with Chakradhar?
No, Chakradhar is... Chakradhar would have a body and then a Tehai, and then the whole thing being played three times. A Tukra would have a body, then the Tehai, and only the Tehai will be played, or the Tehai will be repeated three times, not the body. But the body is being played in Chakradhar. So this is a Tukra, where the body is only played once, but the Tehai is played nine times. Like, Dhedakriti Takradha, Dhedakriti Takradha, Dhedakriti Takradha, 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 Tete Katta, Dhedakriti Takradha, Dhedakriti Takradha, Dhedakriti Takradha, Dhedakriti Takradha, Dhedakriti Takradha, Dhedakriti Takradha. Now, this is anecdote I like to share. I also got this from Omidda. He was present in this concert. This was a concert in 1970s or 1980s, and it was happening in Indoor Stadium, Calcutta. In a recital in Kolkata, Pandit Ravi Shankar abruptly left Abbaji to play a solo in a very high tempo. Now the situation is difficult to manage for people who are not experts in accompaniment, since this is the jhala section we are talking about. However, not daunted, Abbaji very intelligently fit jhaptal in that tempo, in a lowest laya or darja. Like the tempo would have been in the jhala section, like this would have been, and he was left there to play something. So he instantly fit jhaptal in that, and then it went down to the lowest darja. So he got a lot of space to improvise. At that point, that tempo, there was no space to do anything. So he went down and he got a lot of space and he played for 5 minutes. So this presence of mind and command over Laikari is something Abbaji excelled at and is a lesson for all the future generations of musicians and for us, of course. Another thing, I wouldn't say that this is completely his thing, but he definitely made it popular. There's a form called Rang Chadana in Tabla. Rang Chadana as in, you first play a structure of a groove and then fill the same groove with more syllables and create the groove and keep the groove, but create a rela out of it. Rela is a more designed and more filled up composition. Like he would keep the basic groove as dha ta ke ta gina ta gina de gitna ta ta ke ta gina ta gina de gitna dha ta ke ta gina ta gina de gitna ta ta ke ta gina ta gina de gitna, and then filled it up with dha ta ke ta gina ta gina de gitna ta ta ke ta gina ta gina de dha ta ta ke ta gina ta gina de gitna ta ta ke ta gina ta gina de gitna ta ta ke ta gina ta gina de gitna ta ta ke ta gina ta gina de gitna ta ta ke ta gina ta gina de gitna ta ta ke ta gina ta gina de gitna you know, involves the audience more. Otherwise, that rela wouldn't have created so much of impact. Once the concert ends, you go home with that groove. It sets in your head. So that was, I wouldn't say that it was not there because people before him also played. But he definitely made it popular. And Zakirji is an expert in it. Recitation, of course, recitation is a very important aspect of tabla playing, and it's said that Jogesji was kept waiting for 1 year or so. He was only taught to recite and not to play tabla. He was very young, but he was only taught to play recite first. All compositions, ki taal de ke batao ye karo, and then he was taught to play. He could play tabla before because he had learned from somebody, but when he went to Abbaji, he was first taught to recite, and therefore his recitation is fantastic. This is a video which I got where Abbaji recites bowls in Surfaktal. Surfaktal is 10 beats, and he also he will tell you the.
दो ताल ऐसे हैं कि जो अमीर खुसरो के जमाने पे इनको अरूज मिला, मतलब सुल्फाक्ता और फरदस्त, क्योंकि उनका नाम भी फारसी का है, फरदस्त एंड सुल्फाक्ता, ये सुल्फाक्ता हाँ, दिन तक दिन ता दिन दिन ना दिन दिन ना दिन दिन ता दिन दिन ना दिन एक दो तीन एक दो तीन एक दो पांच मात्रा का है, लोग दस का कहते हैं, लेकिन असूल से वो पांच का ही है। दिन तक दिन ता दिन 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 तक दिन ता दिन दिन ता दिन एक दो तीन चार एक दो तीन चार पांच एक दो तीन चार एक दो तीन चार पांच अठाई में गिने एक दो एक दो तीन एक दो तीन एक दो एक दो तीन एक दो तीन एक दो 1 2 3 4 da 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 Data did the Ganatin, the Data did the Ganatin, the Ganatin, the Ganatin, the Ganatin, Abbaji's life, the end of Abbaji's life was both emotional and sentimental. Now, what doesn't appear immediately to those who do not know him is how sensitive he was towards his family. I for myself feel that an artist's professional life is at best very unstable,
vulnerable and full of insecurity. And so his family is possibly the only shelter he can go back to for solace, warmth and happiness. I would like to share this story which I got hold of from Nasreen Munni Kabirji's book. Once, during the time of Kasab, was out of India traveling with Shankar, there was a day when Bawi Begum, his wife, completely ran out of money and could not figure out how to buy food for her children or support her family the next day, in fact. She slept at night and had a dream that Khansab gave her a cloth-made bag which had money in it. In the morning, she woke Zakirji and decided to go to Rajendra Shankar and Lakshmi Shankar's house. Rajendra Shankar was the brother of Ravi Shankarji. However, though they stayed in Mumbai, their house was quite far from Abbaji's residence. Begum reached their home but could not ask for money, and as this was quite fictitious, she was quite hesitant about it. They sat and chatted about life until Lakshmi ji suddenly came out with a cloth bag and said Khansab has sent this for her. There was money in it. Stories like this seem too good to be true, genuinely, but I still can't believe this connect and the integrity, love, loyalty and friendship their relationship portrayed. In today's time, believing in the power of trust is something that is very rare. This is his wife, though I have like really worked hard to get this, and from a source. If anybody has seen his wife, please confirm. Sure?
Yeah.
This is his wife. The photo below is of Rimpa, which happened in Banaras. This has Ravi Shankar ji and Ali Abu Khan sahab duet and Alla Rakha Zakir ji. This was probably the part where they are playing solo, I guess, because both the instruments are kept. I would actually three. Taufik ji is also there. You can see just the face of Taufik ji. Yeah. I don't know how many of you actually know the incident of his death, but I'll read this out because this is rare. This doesn't happen generally. It's disastrous. I'm reading it out from that book of Zakir ji where, you know, Zakir ji is speaking. 2nd February 2000 was a disastrous day for us. Zakir ji speaks. My brother Fazal and I were flying that morning to Kozhikode to play with Ustad Sultan Khan sahab. We were at the Bombay airport and I just had happened to call home and spoke to Razia Appa, who said she was going for her cataract surgery that morning. A year or two earlier, my father had the same procedure at the same clinic and there had been no problem. It was a routine surgery, just a piece of cake. Razia Appa said, you know, Zakir, I'll just go today and get it done. Pray that it goes well. I told Razia Appa to be careful, wished her luck and asked her to keep me posted. They were supposed to give her a local anesthesia, so she had a little breakfast and went to the clinic on her own. Before the procedure could start, she apparently felt a bit uneasy. The nurses did not know what was wrong with her, so they decided to postpone the surgery. After a short while, someone there suggested general anesthesia, thinking it would be easier for Razia Appa. My sister probably agreed to that so that it would be over and done with. Since she had eaten breakfast, they waited a while before the surgery, but not too long or long enough. You're not supposed to eat before going under general anesthesia. As you know, the muscles get paralyzed, so during the operation, the food that she ate earlier entered her windpipe and she started to choke. They suddenly realized what was happening, but they did not have the right equipment or medication to revive her. By the time an ambulance finally arrived, she had already passed away. By the time my younger brother, Tawfiq, who was at home in Bombay, managed to contact us in Kozhikode, we had already played the concert that evening and had just returned to the hotel. The news was utterly shocking. All I could tell Tawfiq was to make sure that someone stayed close to our parents, to make sure they were being looked after. Some of Abba's students went immediately to Simla House, while Fazal and I desperately tried to find a way to get back to Bombay. We tried to hire a helicopter or even charter a plane, but there was nothing we could do because the airport was closed for the night. So Fazal, Sultan Khan Sahab and I drove from Kozhikode to Kochi. We got to Kochi around 4 a.m. in the morning of 3rd February. When we got to the airport, we called home and we were told that Abba had passed away. When he was told about Razia Appa, I believe he did not say a word. Though his students tried hard to distract him, he would not speak to anyone. Abba was very attached to Razia Appa. They were very close. I heard that Abba wandered around the house and even went into my room. Maybe he was thinking, where is Zakir? Perhaps he wanted to talk to me. But that didn't happen. He went to the bathroom and came out, and that's when he had a heart attack. They called the doctor, but it was too late. When Fazal and I returned to Simla House, we arrived to 2 deaths in the family. I mean, how does this happen in anybody's home? It doesn't really. It was very strange. There were already 40 guys from the press who were at the door. Word had spread and it was difficult to manage everything. Ustad Amjad Ali Khan Sahab, Pandit Shiv Kumar Ji, Pandit Hari Prasad Ji were there. Everybody was there. I don't know how they heard the news. Amjad Ali Khan Sahab had come all the way from Delhi. We really had a hard time to find 2 consecutive graves that day. I don't know, but in the book it's written Simla House. It's Nepean Sea Road, right?
There's a Hyderabad house also, so those houses are called that.
Okay.
So how old
were you? He was
80. The daughter who died was the eldest one?
No, not the eldest one. No. So, the Ustad Alla Rakha School of Tabla is based in Mumbai and is run by Ustad Fazal Qureshi. He has a beautiful legacy of rhythm players tirelessly moving the wheels of history every day. His grandson, Shikhar Nad Qureshi, is possibly one of the most talented and well-known young percussionists in India today. Now, at this point, I'd like to apologize in case I've said something or anything untoward across a certain line with my interpretation of Abbaji's life, as I'm still very young and feel that our generation certainly lacks the kind of involvement with the art form which earlier masters displayed. I do respect the argument that the world is changing and life moves faster than what it used to. Jobs are difficult to come by and are opportunities to make a name for ourselves. Nevertheless, it appears to me that we know more about the world, but I guess only superficially. or on the surface. We are actually detached on emotional level as human beings, trying to move between relationships, careers, places as quickly as time and freedom would allow us. This gives us a wider view of the realities of life and the way human beings connect. But I don't really think let us love and care for another person or art form with so much of integrity. I certainly know that I nor many others will ever be able to play like Abbaji, but at the very least hope that someday we may be able to care like him, irrespective of whatever the name of the relationship is, or the kind of work that we do, or the music that we perform. A very dear friend and a thespian by profession once said to me that maybe it would have been a better world if only we were taught to love before learning the use of fire and inventing electricity. I would like to end my presentation with a video of Pandit Ravi Shankar and Ustad Alla Rakha at the Iran Shiraz Festival.